Well, good morning and welcome to worship, church family. I'm going to invite you to stand.
Let praise be a weapon that conquers all.
What an honor and blessing it is to worship that powerful name of Jesus this morning, and we declare it over our lives and over this place and this service. We love you, Lord. In Jesus' precious and holy name, amen. You may be seated.
Hey, Mount Pleasant family. It's been so much fun these last couple of weeks singing some songs with some of my favorite people. I'm going to wrap it up this weekend with a special quartet number. If you were at our night of worship, you saw this. But from the beginning, I wanted to sing a quartet song with my friends David Freeman, John Walker, and Phil Powell. And so here it is. I hope you enjoy it.
Psalm 73, verse 26 says, "My health may fail and my spirit may grow weak, but God remains the strength of my heart. He is mine forever." As a rule, Americans tend to be independent. That's kind of a big deal in our culture. But then the gospel comes in and really challenges that approach to faith, because it says that you can't do this on your own. You're going to fail if you try. And you don't just need a little help. You need someone to do it for you. You need a savior. You see, we are dependent on God. And I want you to listen to this closely. The amount that we recognize our dependence on God, that's the amount that we're going to value him, that we're going to love him, that we're going to trust him and honor him and obey him. You see, because if I think that I only need God a little bit, then I'm only going to value him a little bit. But when we recognize that we need God for everything, from each breath that we take to our eternal hope and security, then we can love him fully. Then we will love him fully. Think about, how much do you recognize your need for God? How much do you think about your dependence on God? As we prepare for our time of communion today, I want you to really think about that, but I also want you to thank him and rejoice because of all that he has done, all that he is doing, and all that he will do for us. Let's pray. Father God, thank you so much for your love. Thank you for your sacrifice. Thank you, God, that we can put all of our weight on you and trust you for every area of our life. There's nothing too small for you. There's nothing too big for you. Thank you for Jesus and for his sacrifice. We pray this in his name. Amen. Hey, before we celebrate the opportunity to give today, I just want to let you know or remind you, I'm sure many of you are probably aware of this, but we've got four charter buses across the street at the SMC full of high school students preparing to go away for a week to move. I just want to encourage you to lift them up in prayer this week. Pray for those students, for the way that they can be impacted by this experience. Pray for the adults. Pray for the volunteers as well. I know that they would appreciate that. But I can speak from my own experience as both a student and a volunteer, the impact that this week can have on the lives of those people involved. So I just want to encourage you to pray for them. We always thank you so much for your generosity here at Mount Pleasant. And we try to make sure that you know all the ways that makes a difference, you know, here in our community, but also around the world. We also thank you and challenge you to participate with us each week in Change for a Dollar, where we ask you to give $1 for every person that's in your family so that we can take that money and then immediately give it away to help a person or a family in need. And we always let you know exactly where that Change for a Dollar money is going. This week's Change for a Dollar recipient is IMPD Officer Michael Kerman. On February 18th, he was in an accident that caused his patrol car to flip. He sustained severe injuries and a traumatic brain injury. Now, over the past several months, he's been recovering well, but he's still not able to drive, and he's still not able to return to work. And that's his goal, to get back to work as fast as possible. So Change for a Dollar is going to allow us to come alongside him and his daughter and help take some of the burden off of their shoulders in a little bit because we're going to help him with some of his household bills and the medical bills that they're dealing with. So we're really excited for that opportunity. Would you pray with me? Father God, thank you so much for your generosity. Help us to always be mindful of the fact that everything we have is yours and that we give out of what you have blessed us with. We pray for Michael. We pray for his recovery. We pray for his daughter as well, as both of them can just continue to deal with this terrible situation, God. We love you. We thank you for Jesus. And we pray this in his name. Amen. Let's celebrate the opportunity to give. Let's check out MPTV.
Hello, and welcome to Mount Pleasant. Thanks for joining us today. My name is Max, and I want to help you get connected. If you're new with us, we're really glad that you're here. It can be a little nerve-wracking to step into a new building with new people for the first time. So we want to help. The first and easiest way to connect with us is to grab your smartphone right now and scan the QR code on one of the seats in front of you. There, you can let us know you're here, share prayer requests, and even give online. It's a great way to raise your hand and say, I'd like to know a little more. If you're the outgoing type and you're ready to meet some people, we'd love to meet you at Guest Connections right after the service. We are now only 1 week away from Pastor Chris's retirement, and we're going to have a celebration worthy of his many, many years of ministry. He's shown up week after week prepared to teach us from God's Word, so we're going to show up next weekend to say thank you. We'll have two services next weekend, one on Saturday, June 29th, and one on Sunday, June 30th. With only two services, space is limited, so please RSVP if you haven't. You'll also want to get here early to find a seat. I'm saying this because I love you, and I don't want to see any of you first and second service folks fighting over your regular seats. On Sunday, immediately following the service, our whole church family is invited to join us for an all-church family picnic, an old-fashioned church barbecue. Lunch and dessert will be provided by MPCC. We'll have fun, games, and inflatables for your kids. This is a really great chance to celebrate and thank Pastor Chris with the whole church family. Before you leave today, you can also pick up the current Soul Care catalog to plan ahead for our classes starting in late summer. Group signups will begin soon. You can grab that catalog in the comments today. For more information and to stay connected, visit us on the web and our social media. Now let's get those Bibles open as we continue in the series, Greatest Hits, with my man, Pastor Chris.
Do you guys have a favorite quote of this?
Amber brought her book.
We brought our book.
Yeah, mine is definitely when the normal sense makes good sense, seek no other sense.
I'm a visual person, so let me hear those pages turning.
Let me hear your pages turn.
Yes.
Let me hear your pages turning.
If you got a Bible with you, let me hear your pages turning to the New Testament book of James. Let me hear your pages turning to the New Testament book of Galatians.
My favorite quote is actually, when the normal sense makes good sense, seek no other sense.
When the normal sense makes good sense, to seek no other sense.
When the normal sense makes good sense, seek no other sense. Anybody ever heard that before?
There is great joy.
Well, I like great joy. I love that. I will always see him raising his arms. Great joy, no joy.
Hey, good morning, church family. If you got a Bible with you, let me hear those pages turning to the New Testament book of 1 Thessalonians. And when you get to 1 Thessalonians, find chapter 5. I wanted to say how much I enjoyed that quartet number with those four guys. And as I mentioned in the video, if you were at our night of worship, you heard that. That wasn't normally scheduled, or the one song that was supposed to be played this weekend, because months ago, I told my daughter, Trisha, who's the worship programming director here, that I wanted to sing a song with Heidi Wright, I wanted to sing a song with her, and I wanted to sing a song with David Freeman and his daughter, Kelly Sponsel. And so, a few weeks ago, we did that. David and Kelly and I met here and with the crew, and we filmed a song, but something went wrong on the technical side of it, and it didn't turn out. And we were going to try to do that again, but as I'm sure that you've noticed, for the past, gosh, longer than I want to think, few months, I've really struggled with my throat and my voice, and so we just weren't able to do that. And so here's a picture of the three of us. We had so much fun. And even though the song didn't turn out, we'll always have that memory, and it was a lot of fun together. Back in January of 2007, we began the calendar year with a message series called The Master's Church. And the text for The Master's Church was 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verses 12 through 22. And the series was basically built on the question, what in the world is the church supposed to be?
And the idea was, as we live in this world, what kind of testimony should the church, should we as believers communicate to the rest of the world? And so we talked about 8 different things from that passage of Scripture. We talked about how important it is for us as the church to be responsible, to be involved, to be joyful, to be prayerful, to be thankful, to be open, to be respectful, and to be discerning. Those were the 8-week messages that we had from that passage. And so we're going to revisit that text today. If you've got your Bible open there and you're able, I'm going to invite you to stand with me and we're going to read Scripture together. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verses 12 through 22. And in my Bible, this comes under the heading Final Instructions. I'm sure your Bible says something similar. Here's what Paul writes. Now we ask you, brothers, to respect those who work hard among you, who are over you in the Lord, and who admonish you. Hold them in the highest regard in love because of their work. Live in peace with each other. And we urge you, brothers, warn those who are idle, encourage the timid, help the weak, be patient with everyone. Make sure that nobody pays back wrong for wrong, but always try to be kind to each other and to everyone else. Be joyful always. Pray continually, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. Do not put out the Spirit's fire. Do not treat prophecies with contempt. Test everything. Hold on to the good. Avoid every kind of evil. All right, there it is. You can be seated. Nobody chose that. All right, there it is. You can be seated. One of my favorite stories, a young couple in our church who've been going here for a few years now, several years now, and they told me one time after they'd been here for a while that their practice was to read a daily devotion together each night as they were getting ready to go to bed. And one night they read the daily devotion, and just out of the blue, spontaneously, the wife said, "All right, there it is, lay down, go to sleep." Don't take that last part seriously here as we dive into the Scriptures this morning. The third message in that Master's Church series was simply be joyful. It was based on 1 Thessalonians 5:16, where Paul, and if you have a hard time memorizing Scripture, here's a great verse to start with, gives us 3 words. It's a verse that only lasts for 3 words. Be joyful always. And as we began that message, this is what I said. This is a direct quote from 2007. I said that I found this statement that really struck me. There is no event or circumstance that can happen in the life of any Christian that should be able to diminish that Christian's joy. And that's so significant. Let's just reinforce it. Read it with me. Let me hear your voices. There is no event or circumstance that can happen in the life of any Christian that should be able to diminish that Christian's joy. How does that strike you this morning? I imagine the initial reaction from some, at least, would be, that's crazy. When you think about all the trouble and all the difficulty and all the pain of life, something like that just doesn't make sense because life can be so hard. But, and I want you to listen close so that there's no misunderstanding, I really believe that you can make the point that no matter how crazy this sounds, the command of Scripture is absolutely clear, and we are to do just exactly what Paul commands us to do in 1 Thessalonians 5:16, and be joyful always. Everyone say always. Always, regardless of our circumstance. But here's the problem. One of the reasons why we can't do that is because we oftentimes have the wrong concept of joy. And that's understandable because it's easy for us as we go through our daily lives to only think about what joy looks like from a worldly perspective. Well, now, back in 2007, when we got to that point in the message, I showed you some video clips of what worldly joy looks like, about what it looks like for people to genuinely rejoice and be joyful. I don't remember all the clips, and I didn't write them all down in my notes, but I do remember one, and so I'll share it with you this morning because I think it's a clip that Hoosiers would really love. Let's watch it together.
Oklahoma has a chance to win it. Gabriel down to the 4 to the 3-yard line. Tackle there, got to go. Clock runs.
I think Texas is just going to hope that their defense can hold on here.
Anderson in motion. 23 seconds. Gabriel has the football. Looks to throw. He's under pressure. He lobs into him.
Sooner Magic, Dylan Gabriel, the legacy-making
I am so sorry. I have no idea where that clip came from. I'm flabbergasted. And I tell you, I know I'm only the pastor here for another week, but heads will roll this week. Somebody is losing their job this week. Let's see if we can find the right clip. Here's the one I thought Hoosiers would really enjoy.
All right, listen up, listen up. Here's what we're going to do. Jimmy, they're going to be expecting you to take the last shot. We're going to use you as a decoy. Buddy, you get the ball, give the rail on the picket fence. He's going to take the last shot. All right, let's go. What's the matter with you guys? What's the matter with you?
I'll make it.
All right. Buddy, get the ball to Jimmy. Top the key. Let's get this. Cut the floor. Let's go. Let's eat.
The score is tied at 40. There are 19 fateful seconds remaining in the game. It'll be inbounded by Hickory in the backcourt, along the sideline, passed in by Ray Butcher, who was responsible for the interception. It goes into Buddy Walker.
That movie. That was in my top five favorite movies before my family ever moved to Indiana in 2001. And I think we can all relate to that example of joy. But I want us to understand that the joy that we just witnessed in that video clip is worldly joy. And the kind of joy that Paul is writing about in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 and verse 16 is something altogether different. So we need to try to understand it on a deeper level. And the difference is this simple. Worldly joy is different than what we might call Christian joy or even biblical joy. And the difference can be summed up like this. Worldly joy is a feeling based on a circumstance. You could even say that it's a feeling based on a feeling. While Christian joy or biblical joy is a feeling based on a fact. We experience worldly joy when the circumstances of our life create joy, like a last-second victory over a hated rival that spawned right from the pit of hell. Or in the case of the movie Hoosiers, when David beats Goliath, and it's just so overwhelming to us. But in contrast to that, Christian joy or biblical joy is a feeling based on a fact. It's an emotional response that's completely based on what we know to be true about God, regardless of what our circumstance might be in the moment. And Christian joy or biblical joy is so much better than worldly joy because no circumstance can touch it. Now, when I shared this message, it was the weekend of January 27th and 28th, 2007. Remember, this was a message series that we started the year off with in 2007. And I used in detail that weekend a specific example of how up and down worldly joy can be in contrast to biblical joy. And here was the example. On New Year's Day, January 1st, 2007, the University of Oklahoma, my beloved Sooners, played Boise State University in the Fiesta Bowl. And from the beginning, it was a train wreck for Oklahoma fans. They played so badly in the first half. Boise State jumped up to a pretty big lead. Oklahoma turned the ball over three times in the first half, including an interception that was returned for a touchdown. And OU trailed Boise State all the way until the fourth quarter. And I was suffering by myself down in the basement of our first house watching this because Sandy learned a long time ago to just separate herself from me in these kinds of moments. And so I'm down in the basement watching this. I'm up and down. I'm pacing. I'm walking back and forth. I'm yelling at the television. But with a minute and 26 seconds left in the fourth quarter, Oklahoma tied the game at 28-28. Now, they kicked the ball off to Boise State. And with 1 minute and 2 seconds left in the fourth quarter, left friends in the game that Oklahoma has trailed from the beginning. There was a miscommunication on the first play from scrimmage between the Boise State quarterback and his wide receiver. The wide receiver ran one route, and the quarterback threw the ball to where he thought the receiver was going to be on another route, and Oklahoma intercepted the ball, returned it for a touchdown. And with a minute and 2 seconds, Oklahoma is ahead 35-28. And I'm doing my best Dennis Hopper impression, jumping up and down and screaming, and I'm thinking how joyful this circumstance is. And Oklahoma kicks the ball off to Boise State, and there's just a little time left on the clock, and the defense stuffs them on the first two plays from scrimmage. And then with 40 seconds left in the game, while Oklahoma's head 35-28, the quarterback for Boise State completes a pass to a wide receiver, and as the defense closes in, he turns and laterals it to another player who runs around the end all the way for a touchdown. And the game ends in a 35-35 tie. So now they're going to go into overtime. Oklahoma gets the ball first in overtime, and their All-American running back, Adrian Peterson, takes a handoff from Paul Thompson, their quarterback at the time, and runs 25 yards for a touchdown. And now Oklahoma is ahead 42-35. Boise State gets the ball on their first possession. They score a touchdown. And rather than kick the extra point and tie the game, they decide they're going to go for it all and go for two. They line up. They run the old-fashioned Statue of Liberty play, the play that you and I run in touch football games when we were a kid, and they score a touchdown on the stupid defense of Oklahoma and win 43-42. People call it the game of the decade. People who aren't Oklahoma fans call it the game of the decade. And if you were here that weekend, you might remember that I literally, as a part of the message to describe the difference between worldly joy and biblical or Christian joy, is I described the up and down nature of the joy that I was experiencing or the lack of joy that I was experiencing by recounting pretty much every single play of the game from the time Oklahoma scored that touchdown to tie the game at 28. And when something good would happen, I would raise my hands and I would go, "Great joy!" And when something bad would happen, I would lower my hands in my head and I would say, "No joy." And something of a phenomenon happened in the 9 o'clock service that weekend because everybody joined in. And by the time we were finished, we were all, "Great joy!" And then no joy. And that's where this t-shirt comes from. And so for the last, that was 2007, for the all these many years, one of the things that people remember most is just that great joy statement, throwing their hands up like Joyce Long said in the video, "Great joy," and wearing these t-shirts, even though this is a constant reminder of one of the greatest disappointments of my life. But it's a classic example of worldly joy that is nothing more than a feeling based on a feeling or a feeling based on a circumstance. Now, can all of us relate to that? We all understand that clearly, don't we? And we can think of things and moments in our lives when we've experienced that kind of joy. During the last part of that game, I was on the phone at the same time with my son, Andrew, who was in Bible college, and my brother, Kenneth, who was in Oklahoma, one on a landline and one on a cell phone, and we were devastated together with no joy. But what we need to understand is that when Paul writes in 1 Thessalonians 5:16 and says, "Be joyful always," this is a joy as believers that we can all experience, because this is a joy that is not based on our feelings. It's not based on the circumstances of our lives. It's based on what we know at all times in every circumstance to be true about God. That's what it's based on. And this is so important for us to understand, because this instruction is found all throughout the New Testament. Maybe not in as straightforward a way as it's found in 1 Thessalonians 5:16, but it's found, for example, in Matthew chapter 5, 11 and 12, as a part of the Beatitudes, which begin the Sermon on the Mount. Jesus says, "Blessed are you when people insult you, persecute you, and falsely say all kinds of evil against you because of me. Rejoice and be glad, because great is your reward in heaven, for in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you." I'm sure all of us know what it's like to be insulted, and maybe some of us know what it's like to have people say evil things against you. It's not fun, and yet we're told by Jesus himself, even in those circumstances, that we can rejoice. Acts 5:41, the apostles, it says this, the apostles left the Sanhedrin. The Sanhedrin was like the Supreme Court of the Jewish religion. The apostles left the Sanhedrin rejoicing, because they had been counted worthy of suffering disgrace for the name. And that comes right after they had been arrested and beaten and flogged. But they were rejoicing as they left. 2 Corinthians 6:10, Paul is talking about the different hardships that he's faced in his life by following Jesus. And they include, for example, beatings and imprisonment. And beginning in verse 10 of 2 Corinthians 6, he says this about himself: sorrowful, yet always rejoicing, poor, yet making many rich, having nothing, and yet possessing everything. James 1, consider it pure joy, my brothers, whenever you face trials of many kinds. 1 Peter 1:6, in this you greatly rejoice, though now for a little while you may have had to suffer grief in all kinds of trials. Do you see what I'm saying? There's a difference between worldly joy that's feeling based on a feeling or feeling based on a circumstance and the kind of joy Paul commands in 1 Thessalonians 5:16, which is joy based on the fact, based on the unchanging truth that we know about God. I don't know that there's a better example of this lived out than the story of Paul and Silas when they were in Philippi in Acts chapter 16. Some of you have been with me to Greece and Turkey, and we visited the city of Philippi. We walked on the ruins of the city of Philippi, and there's a place that's identified as the jail there. No one can say for sure that's where it was, but you've seen that with me. Paul and Silas were thrown into prison because they had upset the local people in Philippi with their preaching and with their ministry. And Acts 16:25 says, about midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God. In other words, they were rejoicing while they were in prison. And they weren't just doing that sitting around a comfortable cell. They did that after they had been stripped and beaten. Acts 23 said that they were severely flogged. Their bleeding wounds would have gone untreated. They would have been placed in a seated position with painful leg and wrist irons placed on them. If they had gotten their clothes back, they would have just been placed on their bodies to mingle with their open and untreated wounds. The cell was probably dark and cold and filled with the sickening smell of other prisoners. And yet here they are praying and singing hymns. Here they are rejoicing and being joyful. How could they do that? Because they couldn't have felt that way. Their circumstance didn't set them up for that. How could two mistreated, beaten, and bleeding believers be joyful enough to sing and pray when they're in prison, not knowing what the next hour would hold? Well, they could do that because they knew that joy was not a feeling based on a feeling. It was not a feeling based on a circumstance. It was a feeling based on a fact. And nothing that had happened to them, no matter how bad it was, how painful it was, how frightening it was, how unfair it was, would change what they knew and understood to be true about God their Father. And that's the way God wants all of us to live. Something we have to learn. It's imperative for us to learn how to do this. And so if Christian joy or biblical joy is feeling that's based on a fact, then we need to spend some time talking about the facts about God that you and I know that will never change, Because we have a limited amount of time, I'm just going to focus on some of the more obvious ones as we move through the rest of this message. How about this? Number one, if you like to take notes, you can write this down somewhere. God's character never changes. The character of our sovereign God never, ever changes. He is not one way on Monday and another way on Tuesday. Psalm 28 and verse 7 says, "The Lord is my strength and my shield. My heart trusted in him and I am helped. Therefore, my heart greatly rejoices and with my song I will praise him." Now, the part of that verse that stands out to me is when the psalmist says, "My heart greatly rejoices." Why? Why could we say in our lives of faith that our heart greatly rejoices? Would it be because our circumstances are always good, that we always feel emotionally feel joyful? No. We can say that because God is God, because of who God is and the fact that he never changes. He can be trusted and to be the same yesterday, today, and tomorrow. Psalm 71:23 says, "My lips shall greatly rejoice," note this, "when I sing to you." And basically the psalmist is saying of God, when I think about you, when I turn my attention to you, and that's what we do when we sing about him. When we sing about the beautiful name of Jesus, who is God the Son, we're thinking about God, we're reflecting on God. And when we do that, we're filled with joy because the character of God never, ever changes. It's like a rock that never moves. It's something we can count on. We can count on God's love. We can count on God's kindness. We can count on God's mercy and God's forgiveness. And you can go on and on and on. Everything about God never changes. I've gone through more sad, painful, and unfair experiences in my life, and I'm sure you could say the same thing, than I could even count or remember. But I have never, ever, not once in my life, been disappointed in the character of God. I've never questioned the character of God. I've had questions about why God chose to allow something to happen or why God didn't intervene in something, but I have never, ever had a question about the fundamental character of God, the goodness of the character of God. Here's another thing that never changes: God's salvation. When you stop and consider what God has done for us through the sacrificial death of his son Jesus on the cross, you can't help but rejoice regardless of how you might be feeling in the moment or regardless of your circumstance. And friends, this is something we really need to focus on because this is the heart of the biblical message. The heart of the biblical message is this truth: when we, you and me, I'm talking about you and me, not somebody else, you and me, when we were completely unworthy, when we were completely undeserving, God, out of nothing more than his love and his grace and his mercy, sent his son Jesus Christ into the world to die in our place on the cross of Calvary so that our sin could be forgiven and we could have a chance to live in a right relationship with him forever. That's why the angel who appeared to those shepherds outside of Bethlehem, many of you have been with me to Israel, to the shepherd's field, on that night Jesus was born, said, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news of great joy that will be to all the people. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is Christ the Lord." Look at these words on the screen from Romans chapter 5, verses 6 and 8. What a powerful passage of scripture this is. Paul says, you see, at just the right time, when we were still, notice how he describes us, powerless, Christ died for the ungodly. Very rarely will anyone die for a righteous man, though for a good man someone might possibly dare to die. But God demonstrates his own love for us in this: while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Let me ask you a question. Have those words lost any significance or power in your life? Maybe because you're so familiar with them, you've heard them so many times. 1 Peter 1, 8 and 9 says, "Though you have not seen him, you love him. And even though you do not see him now, you believe in him and are filled with an inexpressible and glorious joy. For you are receiving the goal of your faith, the salvation of your souls." That's where that joy comes from. And that salvation that God offers us, it doesn't change. No circumstance changes the truth about salvation. Changes the truth that it is a gift from God by his grace to everyone who believes. And if you're a Christian this morning, as you listen to my voice, either in person or as you're listening to me online, and I want to welcome all you folks online, then you need to understand the great joy that there is in the salvation that God gives us as a result of his love and grace and mercy that we have never deserved and we could never earn. How about God's Spirit? Here's another unchanging thing about God. God's Spirit. When I say God's Spirit, I'm talking about the Holy Spirit. One of the greatest blessings of the Christian life is the indwelling presence of God's Spirit, the Holy Spirit, who enters your life upon salvation and lives inside of you as a Christian to be your supernatural resource to help you live the Christian life. This is the truth the Bible tells us about God, that there is one God, but the Bible tells us that He is a triune God. Triune God. What does that mean? It means that He is one God who exists at all times in three persons: God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit, or just God the Spirit, God the Father, God the Son, and God the Spirit. And when you put your faith and trust in Jesus, God the Son, for your salvation, and you receive the gift of salvation, which is a gift of God's grace, then one of the first things that happens is God the Holy Spirit begins to live inside of you. He dwells inside of you. The very presence of God lives inside of you. And He lives inside of you to be a resource to help you live the Christian life. And because the Holy Spirit is in our lives, we need to understand that He plays a critical role in the ability for us to experience biblical or Christian joy. We don't have any problems. We don't need any help when it comes to experiencing worldly joy. We can do that on our own. Nobody even has to tell us how to do it or talk to us about it. We know that worldly joy is a feeling based on a feeling. When we feel joyful, we express joy. When we have circumstances of joy in our lives, we feel and express joy. But Christian joy, biblical joy, again, is something different. And we need the help of the Holy Spirit in order to do this. In fact, if we go back to our text, we can say the foundation of everything that we're talking about in this message today is that simple three-word command Paul makes, gives to us, rather, in 1 Thessalonians 5:16, when he says, be joyful always. And we know what that joy is. It's not a feeling on top of a feeling. It's a feeling on top of a fact. And we're talking about those facts right now, the character of God, the salvation of God, the Holy Spirit of God. But here's something we need to understand as we talk about this. This was really beneficial to me when I just came to this basic realization. This joy that we're commanded to have as Christians, it's not natural for us. And so if you struggle with it, then you need to understand that. One of the reasons why you struggle with this kind of joy, feeling joyful, being joyful even in difficult circumstances, because it does not come natural for us. Regardless of the depth of our faith sometimes or how long we've been a Christian, it does not come natural for us. And God understands that. God not only understands that, friends, I want you to listen to me close. He acknowledges it. And He acknowledges it by giving us His very presence to live inside of us as a spiritual resource for us to live the Christian life, which is what the Holy Spirit does as He indwells us at salvation. In fact, if we had the time, I would have you turn with me to Galatians 5, but we don't have the time, so I'm just going to read it to you. Galatians 5, verses 22 and 23, the Apostle Paul talks about the fruit of the Spirit. If you remember, not long ago, we went on a chapter-by-chapter study through the book of Galatians. We got to chapter 5, and we talked about a contrast between the acts of the flesh, or the sinful nature, and the fruit of the Spirit. The sinful nature comes from ourselves, but the fruit of the Spirit is what happens when the Holy Spirit lives inside of us and we live by the Spirit or we walk by the Spirit. And he says, but the fruit of the Spirit is love, here it is, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such things there is no law. And so in that verse, we see firsthand the kind of joy that we're talking about here, this biblical joy or this Christian joy that is a feeling, not based on a feeling or circumstance, but a feeling based on a fact. And here's what we need to understand. It's not natural. It doesn't come naturally to you and me. And the reason why is it is supernatural. It's something that God, through the ministry of the Holy Spirit, produces inside of us. And that's why we read, but the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness, faithfulness, and self-control. The fruit of the Spirit, this biblical Christian joy, for example, is something God wants to produce in you through the presence of His Holy Spirit. Think of it like this. The fruit of the Spirit represents the kind of change that God wants to see take place in the lives of people who are believers. And it's a change that begins on the inside where the Holy Spirit dwells, where God the Spirit dwells, and then it works its way out. It's not something that you and I can manufacture on our own. The worst thing that can happen, the absolute worst thing that can happen today, is we can come to church, we can go through this message, and we can identify the fact that there's a difference between worldly joy and biblical joy. Worldly joy is a feeling based on a feeling or a feeling based on a circumstance. We're joyful when things are good in our life. Biblical joy is a feeling based on fact, the unchanging truth that we know about God. It would be wrong if we came and we listened to that message and then we walked out and we tried to produce that biblical joy on our own through our own sheer grit and determination. And you walk out and you find that you got a flat tire. Praise the Lord, I got a flat tire. And so you go through that effort of changing the tire or whatever you would do if you get a flat tire, and you go out the rest of your day, and then something else bad happens. You say, praise the Lord, I wish this didn't happen, but praise the Lord this happened. You know, and you're just trying to gut it out on your own. Sooner or later, you're going to come to the end of that ability because you can't produce this on your own. You can't. None of us can. You can't. I can't. No one can. We can't produce this kind of joy, this kind of fruit of the Spirit based on our own effort, our own grit and determination. It's something that God produces in us through the indwelling presence of the Holy Spirit. Here's the pattern. This joy flows from God the Father through God the Holy Spirit through you. It begins with God the Father, it flows down to God the Holy Spirit, and then ultimately it flows through you. But this can only happen when you live by the Spirit, when you walk by the Spirit, which is another way to describe when you submit to the presence of the Holy Spirit in your life day after day after day, the work that He wants to do inside of you. And so the role of the Holy Spirit is absolutely critical when it comes to being able to be joyful always, knowing that there's a difference between worldly joy and biblical joy. And you can count as a believer, as a Christian, you can count on the Holy Spirit, God the Holy Spirit, to always be at work in your life through every circumstance of life, trying to make you into the person God wants you to be. But not if you deny His presence in your life. Not if your life is filled with sin that offends the God the Holy Spirit inside of you. Not if you never give any attention to Him. Only when you submit to Him, only when you live by the Holy Spirit or walk by the Holy Spirit. How does that happen? Well, it's hard. It's sometimes hard to describe in just simple words. But let me just tell you that one day this week, I do a daily devotion every day, like I'm sure you do, and I begin my day like that in my home. And one day this week, the words of the devotion just really, really especially spoke to my heart. I've been reading this devotion by this guy who, for the last couple of weeks, he's been talking about humility with a special emphasis of humility in leadership. And he's telling the story about a time in the Old Testament when the Philistines captured the Ark of the Covenant, which represented the very presence of God. I mean, the Ark of the Covenant that contained the Ten Commandments and a jar of manna and Aaron's staff. If you know the story of the Old Testament about Aaron, who was the brother of Moses, and how his staff budded one time. And it was the very presence of God. And having that Ark just wreaked havoc on the Philistines until they got to the point where they finally got smart enough to give it back. And there's a lot of different aspects of the story, but there was a special emphasis on humility in this one that just pierced my heart. Just pierced my heart. Made me pause. Made me pause and think and read and study beyond just the devotional thought that day. And really shaped and formed the words of my prayer that morning. And just made such an impact on my life that I'm still thinking about it today. Well, when I have moments like that, and I'm not going to mislead you, I don't have moments like that every day. But when I have moments like that, you know who's working in my life over time? God the Holy Spirit. Because I'm submitting to Him and I'm walking by the Spirit and I'm living by the Spirit and I'm focused on the Spirit and He's changing my life from the inside out. And that's how this happens. You're not going to experience this supernatural level of being able to be joyful, regardless of the feeling or the circumstance. If you totally ignore this resource, this divine resource that's living inside of you, you can't do that. If you're just going through your day and giving no thought to God or your spiritual life or your spiritual commitments, that's not how it happens. That's not how it works. You got to walk by the Spirit, live by the Spirit. You can't ignore the Spirit and get the blessing of the Spirit. And when it comes to this command to be joyful always, we absolutely have to have this blessing from the Spirit, because this command to be joyful always does not come naturally to sinful, fallen, fleshly people like you and me. We know how to experience worldly joy, but we don't always know how to experience biblical joy. Well, we could go on. There are so many other aspects to this. There's God's blessing. That never changes. Ephesians 1:3 says, "Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in the heavenly realms with every spiritual blessing in Christ." You stop and think about all that you have through the presence of Christ in your life, and that he gives you access, literally, Paul says, to every spiritual blessing that God can give. Then how can you not find joy in that? How about God's divine providence? We love the words of Romans 8:28. And we know that in all things God works for the good of those who love him and who have been called according to his purpose. The Bible tells us that God, listen, think about this. The Bible tells us that God literally has the ability to orchestrate every single piece of time and space and manner in life. Every single piece of time and space and matter in life to work it ultimately for your good and for his glory. Somebody say amen to that. How about God's promise of heaven? How about the joyful truth that no matter what's going on in this life, we know that one day we're promised to be released from all of this life so that we can spend eternity in the presence of God? That's why when Paul was in a prison or a jail cell and he wrote the letter to the church in Philippi, he was able to write in Philippians 1:21, "For to me, to live is Christ, to die is gain." He was conflicted, not knowing if he wanted to just continue to live and serve God in a productive way or just die and have it all be over so he could be in the presence of God. He said, "For me to live is Christ and to die is gain." We could talk about God's promise to answer our prayers, God's gift of the scriptures, God's gift of the church, of spiritual Christian fellowship with one another, brotherhood with one another, and on and on and on. These are all facts about God that never, ever change. And that is the foundation to be able to obey the simple sounding command of 1 Thessalonians 5:16, be joyful always. Because joy, Christian joy, is not a feeling that's based on a feeling or a circumstance. It's a feeling based on a fact. And if you and I can really understand and embrace that truth in our lives, then there's not a moment in our lives, no matter what's happening to us, where we can't raise our hands and say, what am I going to say? Say it with me. Great joy in the presence of a God who never changes. Look at these words on the screen from Psalm 36:7. "How precious, O God, is your constant love. We find protection under the shadow of your wings." Nothing about God ever changes. So how are you doing with joy this morning as we come to a close? How are you doing with joy? How would you assess yourself if somebody graded you on that one simple command from 1 Thessalonians 5:16, where Paul says, be joyful always? Can I tell you in great honesty this morning as we close that I feel a genuine sadness in my life as my time with you comes to an end, just a week away. And I could even say it's a profound sadness. It's a sadness unlike anything I've ever felt before. Some of it's because of the loss. A great deal of it is because of the loss of this right here, this connection, and this experience, and this influence. Some of it's based on disappointing circumstances. But at the same time, I can tell you with integrity that I feel the joy of God in my life. because I know I made this decision in concert with him, and I know that he's in control of the next chapter of my life, just like he's in control of the next chapter of yours as a church family. And so, we can say together, even in the midst of the sadness, great joy. Father in heaven, we love you so much. You are such a good God, and that never changes. And we praise you today. We honor you. We lift you up. We adore you. We worship you. We're so thankful. And I pray that you would just really speak to our hearts, move in our lives today. I don't know what circumstance everyone finds themselves in this morning, what's happening in their lives, maybe behind the scenes. I'm so thankful for everyone who is here. I'm thankful for those who are here, even though maybe being here was not their first choice today. But out of faithfulness, out of reverence, respect, and out of acknowledgement for your sovereignty and goodness, they're here today to worship you, even if they don't necessarily feel a closeness to you in this moment. Just remind us that you never change, that you are God of love and grace and mercy constantly, and you always walk with us. You never leave us or forsake us. You always have a perfect plan for our lives. And I pray for anybody today who's struggling to experience joy in their life right now, that the Holy Spirit who lives inside of them would be prodding their heart and speaking to their heart and guiding their heart. And that they would be honest and open enough to just admit the struggle so that they can draw near to you and experience the reality of you drawing near to them. Thank you for this church, these people, this service, this message, this truth. We love you so much. In Jesus' name we pray. And everyone said, amen. Amen. Hey, stand together. We're going to sing one more song before we dismiss, and we're going to celebrate some baptisms this morning. I'm going to invite prayer counselors to come down today. And I'm just going to give you a challenge this morning. I'm just going to challenge you by saying, listen, if you're here today and you can be honest enough to say you're struggling with joy in your life, maybe you're walking through a particularly difficult moment or season of life, or there's something that you don't understand and you've got questions about that's just conflicting in your life right now, would you just come down and let somebody pray for you? Just take a step toward God this morning and let somebody pray for you about that. You don't have to tell them the story of your life or give them a lot of detail, but just let somebody pray for you today. And if you have any other kind of a burden or concern or need this morning, whatever it might be, you come and let somebody pray for you today.
If it's bandaging the broken or washing filthy feet, here I am, Lord, send me. If it's loving one another, even when we don't agree, here I am, Lord, send me.
be glad I chose to say,
as our final act of worship, we're going to witness baptisms.
All right, church family, I'm so thrilled to be in the baptistry today with Ashley Keene. She's got all her family, her husband, and all her girls over here, and lots of friends. And Ashley comes today to make a public profession of her faith in Christ, which she's already done, and express that faith through baptism. So Ashley, I take my right hand and repeat after me in the presence of God and these witnesses. I believe that Jesus is the Christ.
That Jesus is the Christ.
The Son of the living God.
The Son of the living God.
And I confess him.
And I confess him.
As the Lord of my life.
As the Lord of my life.
That's a great confession, Ashley. And because of that confession, I now baptize you, my sister, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. All right. And this is Marina Rautenkrantz, and she comes also today to make that public profession and express her faith in Christ through baptism. So I want to take your right hand and have you repeat that same confession, okay? I believe that Jesus is the Christ.
That Jesus is the Christ.
The Son of the living God.
The Son of the living God.
And I confess him.
And I confess him.
As the Lord of my life.
As the Lord of my life.
That's a great confession. And also now, because of that confession, baptize you, Marina, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Well, good morning. This is a good friend of mine, Emery, and I am so excited for him and his family. And Emery is one of my three favorite triplets. He is one of my favorite of the three, and I've known him since he was in our preschool. And for so many years, I'm just so excited to be able to share with him in this moment as he professes his faith through baptism. So, Emery, I'm going to ask if you would to repeat after me. I believe that Jesus is the Christ.
That Jesus is the Christ.
The Son of the living God.
The Son of the living God.
And I confess him.
And I confess him.
As the Lord of my life.
As the Lord of my life.
Upon your confession, I now baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Good morning. My name is Kate Pope, and this is my daughter, Sarah, and she is also here today to proclaim the Lord as her Savior. Sarah, I want you to repeat after me. I believe that Jesus is the Christ.
That Jesus is the Christ.
The Son of the Living God.
The Son of the Living God.
And I confess him.
And I confess him.
As my Lord and Savior.
As my Lord and Savior.
I now baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Well, all right, I'll ask you to stand and I'll close us in prayer together this morning. Father, thank you so much. What a great joy and privilege it is to witness these baptisms today as the end of our worship service. We pray, Lord, that you would seal the truth that has been shared, the conviction of the Holy Spirit to our hearts. Help us to go out with great joy, true joy in you. Send us, Father, lead us, and bring us back safe next weekend to celebrate Pastor Chris. We love you, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. Once again, if you're a guest, we'd love to say hello to you outside these doors to the right in guest connections. See you next weekend.